So today we would be starting with solid waste. When we talk about solid waste is something which we start creating right from the morning we get up. So the vegetables that was cooked at your home, some waste was created out of it that you throw in the dustbin there, which is eventually taken by municipality people. You may have got up in the morning and may have use some rough sheets, and then you may have used those, thrown those rough sheets, the napkins that you perhaps may have used, the diapers that you may have used, that you have removed. All those things are solid waste. Similarly, there may be some construction going on around your house. Though they create solid waste, industries create solid waste. So there are different forms of solid waste that we create every day. In fact, as per the report by Planning Commission in 2014, India produced 62 million tons of solid waste. And it is expected that this overall solid waste is going to keep increasing. By 2030, it will become 165 million tons. Now, we create this much solid waste. A large part of municipal solid waste which is created in urban household areas, is collected. Like collection efficiency is around 70%, 70 to 80%. But after it is collected, what happens to it? Most of the solid waste is dumped into the landfills. Very small amount of it is treated. Only 20% of the waste is treated. Rest of it is dumped into the landfills. We'll talk about some landfills today, and is not treated. Now, what are the different ways in which we dispose of solid waste? That is something that we want to understand. Different ways in which we can dispose of solid waste, or we generally dispose of solid waste. There are good ways of disposing it off. There are some bad ways of disposing it off. Every way has its advantages and limitations. We'll talk about all those advantages and limitations as well. Okay, the first is the most common way that is used in India. 80% of our collected waste either go for open dumping or landfills. What is it? It's simply this. Let's say in a new township is being set up. Outside the township, there may be a small area which has some depression, or which may not even have depression. That city, that town will start dumping some waste here. It may be outside the city, but as city expands, this becomes part of the city, and this becomes huge pile, mountain of waste. In fact, it was said that the Okhla landfill site in Delhi. So see, Okhla was initially a kind of outside Delhi, outside the main township of Delhi, but now Okhla is part of Delhi. It is said that if we had not taken proper action, then the height of Okhla would have gone beyond Qutub Minar. Okay, this is normally you take your waste and dump it in the landfills or open dump sites. Now, there are problems associated with these mechanisms. What are the problems which would be associated with these mechanisms? Problems would include, like, waste is just lying there, organic waste is there. Decomposition and everything will produce methane. Methane is a combustible gas. Any spark will lead to fire. So these landfill fires have become a major cause of concern. In urban areas, it is a big issue. Sometimes if this landfill catches fire, it pollutes the whole city. Mumbai may very recently we had seen cases. Delhi may we had seen cases, Kolkata may we had seen cases. Now, dousing off this landfill fire is very difficult because it's burning methane also. So it causes air pollution. A lot of waste just gets burned off like that. Then when rainfall occurs, it gets water. Water gets seeped into the ground, and along with it also takes a number of hazardous things. These landfill sites may have e-waste also, which would have what do you call heavy metals. These landfill sites would have plastic waste also, which would have various carcinogenic substances. So all that gets into the groundwater, or all that with the flow of water gets into the river. It also causes water pollution. Air pollution to ye cause kar raha tha. It's also causing water pollution. Hai na? Think of soil pollution. All that waste into the soil only. It would add to soil pollution. So there are so many different problems that open dumping in the landfills would be causing. Okay, then there's a mechanism called sanitary like empty ground here you started dumping waste. In sanitary landfills we'll do this, we'll put a layer on top of it first so that bad things will not get into the ground. So let's say plastic ka layer or any such protective reason system would be created. This would be sanitary landfills. Now sanitary landfills are also not that effective. Here also fires can take place. Here also when this pile gets large, flow of water, rainfall will take away a lot of it to the, so it perhaps reduces ground pollution, but it does not solve all other kinds of pollution. This was sanitary landfill. Now, this was one way of dumping waste, but it has a number of limitations. Then comes thermal treatment mechanism. In thermal treatment mechanism, there are 2-3 different methods. Okay, one method is incineration plants. Incineration plants are nothing. These are the places where you'll burn the waste in the presence of oxygen. It's like your household, from your household, a lot of waste goes out, which has high calorific value. It may contain wood material. It may contain plastic. A lot of these things would be there, which will have high calorific value. You burn that. So by burning it, you're reducing the overall quantity, only ash is left. At the same time, you're producing heat, you're producing energy, which can be converted into electricity. So this is the waste to energy mechanism. But here, there would be a number of issues. There would be a number of problems. What would be the issues? What would be the problem? First of all, you're burning waste. You're producing a lot of CO2. And this is not coal, which is mostly carbon. There's a lot of other things are in there. They will add a lot of pollutants in the atmosphere. It will also add to CO2 in the atmosphere, which will lead to climate change, and all those issues would be there. If not segregated properly, a number of heavy metals would also be there, which may vaporize in this kind of incineration plant and would get into the air, which would create all kinds of problem. Incineration is one method which is being used, but it also has a number of limitations. Okay, then another method is called pyrolysis. In pyrolysis, what is done? See, in incineration, the burning happened in presence of oxygen. So normal, like you burn something, aag lag gayi, that was incineration. In pyrolysis, heat would be provided, but oxygen will not be provided. So burning will not happen. But because of very high temperature, the complex compounds would break into simpler compounds. The volatile things will convert in the gas form, which will be usable. And what you will be left with would be a carbon char or char-like thing, which can be used as fuel. So all the waste, you treat them with high temperature, without providing them oxygen, so they'll not burn. Things which can be converted into gas or gaseous things would be released. So the volatile products, you can get certain gas which can be used as fuel, which can be used for other purposes. Those would be volatile products. And then there will be solid residue left, which will be carbon char, which can also be used as fuel. So this is pyrolysis. What is the key difference? Here, heating is happening in the absence of oxygen. Then there's another method, which is in the process of development, which is being used in some places, and India is also planning to use it. That is plasma arc gasification process. Ye to bhi PIB mein news mein bhi tha when India had experimenting with this mechanism. Plasma arc gasification. Here also, we're not providing oxygen. See, we are studying all this under thermal methods. So incineration is one thing that we studied. Pyrolysis is another thing that we studied. Now we have plasma arc gasification process. What is happening in this? We are providing high temperature along with electric current. High temperature diya ja raha hai along with electric current. So what this leads to is it converts organic waste into gas and it converts inorganic waste. If from your house you'll also release a lot of inorganic waste which goes into municipal solid waste into slag. Slag would have its own uses. These gases can be used as fuel and for other purposes. Okay, are we able to understand clear differentiation between incineration, pyrolysis and plasma arc gasification? Here organic waste would be converted into gas. I hope understanding is clear here. You people are able to understand all the three things very clearly. Now you'll see pyrolysis and plasma arc gasification are not very polluting in nature. Incineration mein to aapne aag laga di. This is not happening here in pyrolysis and plasma arc gasification process. Now let's go to biological treatment of waste. Biological treatment. In biological treatment, first we have biogasification. Now what is biogasification? Biogas jo create karte the na hum by like animal waste ko ek bade se tank mein dal ke anaerobic decomposition of the animal waste would take place, that will lead to production of gas, production of biogas. Biogasification is that. Here the household waste which is organic in nature, the vegetable. In the morning you may have had bhindi, but some part of bhindi, some part of that lady finger goes into the dustbin. You may have had lauki, you may have had eggs, or you may not have had some eggs and you may have thrown it. All this is organic waste. When you cut vegetable, to palak ka ek hissa khate ho, ek hissa fek dete ho. That is organic waste. All these organic waste can be decomposed by bacterias, by microorganisms to produce what is known as biogas. But this is only for organic waste. And biogas mostly contains methane, which is inflammable as we already know it. Okay, then we have composting, another mechanism. In composting, decomposition, the name composting comes from there. Here also microorganisms are used to break organic waste into what is known as compost. This compost is rich in nutrients. Jaise hamare organic products mein nutrients the, this compost is rich in nutrients and thus can be used for as soil conditioners, as fertilizers. They can also act as humus and could be added as humus in the soil. They could also act as natural pesticides and then erosion control ke liye, landfill cover ke liye, land and sea reclamation ke liye. In all these places you could use this composting. Then we have vermiculture or vermicomposting. What is vermiculture or vermicomposting? Here, rather than using any microorganisms, when we are talking about decomposing organic waste, we used the various species of worms, vermicomposting. Here we use different species of worms to convert our organic waste into compost. This compost is called vermicompost. So these are usually red wigglers, white worms and earthworms. So other than converting organic waste into these things, they also leave a lot of their excreta, which adds to the value in that vermicomposting. So the vermicomposting is another mechanism. Okay, so far how do we deal with solid waste? We have talked about landfills. Normally this is generally what is being done, but then we talked about thermal mechanisms. In thermal mechanisms, we had incineration, burn it in the presence of oxygen, pyrolysis, heat it in the absence of oxygen, where you'll get some gas, some car like things, and then we had arc gasification, plasma arc gasification, where in the presence of electricity, in the presence of heat, the waste is broken down into useful components. Okay. Some people are still saying they're not. No need. Is it still a problem, guys? Is audio still a problem? No. Okay.
No, sir.
Great. So these are the different ways in which we can treat our municipal solid waste or our solid waste. Right now, most of this is not being treated. Only 20% treatment is happening. Rest is getting into the landfills and all. Now, there's another thing called bioremediation. So, remedy kya hota? Remedy is solution. Right? Bioremediation is treatment of solid waste with using some components of biology. So, for example, using microorganisms and all, you will treat solid waste to reduce its toxicity, to reduce its harmfulness. That is bioremediation. So here you would see that we stimulate the growth of microorganisms, and these microorganisms can degrade the pollutants and thus reduce the polluting power of municipal solid waste. Fine. So this is bioremediation. Now bioremediation can be done in 2-3 different ways. One, naturally occurring microorganisms could be used. Like in that area, some microorganisms would be naturally occurring. You may stimulate them to grow more. Then those microorganisms will take care of the waste, will reduce the toxicity, polluting capability of the waste. Then another way of bioremediation is what is known as bioaugmentation. In bioaugmentation, you select some microorganisms which have highly degrading properties. Rather than just using the naturally occurring microorganisms of that area, you augment, you add some microorganisms which will have these highly degrading properties. Okay, now please understand that these two methods are not mutually exclusive. You may use naturally occurring ones also, and then you may add outside microorganisms which are highly degrading in nature. These do not have to be exclusive. You know, only use naturally occurring ones or only use the outside ones. Both these things may go on together. So this is bioremediation. Okay. At last, we have biomining. So far, ek to normal landfill mechanism, thermal mechanism, biological mechanism where we used either bioremediation or vermicomposting or composting or biogasification, those kind of things. In at last, what we have is called biomining. In biomining, what we do, municipal solid waste, that municipal solid waste is segregated into different products, plastic, separate plastic, used plastic for its purposes, wooden things, glass things, metallic things, soil. It will have some soil also. Let's segregate it into these components and use it accordingly. That is biomining. How do you extract iron from nature? You mine for it. Here, mining would happen from the waste. This waste may also be containing a lot of these resources. This is biomining. Fine. So different ways in which municipal solid waste is dealt with, or solid waste is dealt with. You should understand these terms because UPSC tend to ask these questions. Ki bioaugmentation kya hota hai? So you should be able to answer that those concepts. Okay. Now there are 3 landfills in Delhi which remain in news all the time. Which are these 3 landfills? These landfills are the Bhalsawa landfill, the Okhla landfill, and the Ghazipur landfill. These are the 3 major landfills in Delhi, where most probably when your waste द म्युनिसिपैलिटी इज कलेक्टिंग योर वेस्ट, सुबह सुबह जो आते हैं ना गाना बजाते हुए, नहीं दैट्स अ वेरी गुड प्रैक्टिस, पर वो सुबह सुबह नहीं आते, आजकल 9-10 बजे आ रहे हैं, आई एम नॉट एबल टू मीट देम. दे वुड इवेंचुअली टेक योर वेस्ट टू वन ऑफ दीज डंप साइट्स. नाउ लुक एट द साइज ऑफ दीज डंप साइट, द वेस्ट दैट दे ऑलरेडी हैज. भालसुआ हैज 80 लाख टन्स ऑफ वेट ऑलरेडी देयर. ओखला हैज 56.4 लाख टन्स ऑफ वेस्ट. गाजीपुर हैज 139.9 लाख टन्स ऑफ वेस्ट, रफली 270-280 मिलियन टन लाख टन्स ऑफ वेस्ट और 26 मिलियन टन्स ऑफ वेस्ट इज हैज बीन डंप्ड हियर. इट हैज केप्ट ऑन ग्रोइंग थ्रू आउट द ईयर, थ्रू आउट मेनी ईयर्स. लाइक 1980 से कुछ डंप साइट्स हैं. At that time, Delhi was not that large. They started dumping their waste there. But now, they're all part of the city. And within city, we have these large dump sites. But the three municipalities, like three dump sites, three different parts of Delhi, and thus different urban bodies are responsible for those areas. So the three municipalities have said that they'll be targeting to flatten these three dump sites by 2024. By 2024, these three main dump sites. There are other dump sites also in Delhi, but these are the three main landfills in Delhi which will be targeted to be flattened. What is it? Now, concerns. Dekho, concerns I've already discussed. I think odor pollution is something that I didn't discuss. Otherwise, air pollution, groundwater pollution, wastage of resources, breeding ground for diseases, ye we can understand. Odor pollution is the smell, bad smell. If you go near these landfill sites, you'll not be able to tolerate the smell that emanates from there. And it may go to hundreds of meters. It's not like only when you are very near to these dump sites, you'll have that bad smell. Even 500 meters away, 800 meters away, you'll be able to get that smell. And this smell would make your life difficult. The smell will make you feel nauseated. The smell will give you headache. This smell would make you feel as if yaar kahan reh rahe hain. But a lot of people live around these dump sites. Unke liye aadat ho gayi hai. They are not realizing that health issues are being caused by the smell also. A lot of people work in these dump sites. Okay, similarly, when all these things are dumped there, it's wastage of a lot of resources. A toy breaks down, you throw it in the dustbin. It has plastic, it has metal, the resources. Sometimes people even throw their mobile phones. Arey, pheko na ise, bahut purana ho gaya. They do that. It has a lot of resources there. All that gets for waste. And these landfill sites are also breeding ground for a lot of diseases. Dengue, malaria, and whatnot. Up to when you do not dispose of, like a lot of us, when the mask that we have used, we end up throwing it in the dustbin. Hum biomedical waste karke ek alag component nahi bana rahe hain. So they may also be sites from where COVID kind of diseases could spread. You're getting the issue. Okay, so it may be breeding ground for diseases. So the three municipal bodies are saying that by 2024, they'll do away with it. So usmein jaise Bhalsua, the first one, the second largest one, it is under North Delhi Municipal Corporation. And they're saying that by June 2022, here, Bhalsua, by June 2022, the North Delhi Municipal Corporation would flatten it. Then we have Okhla, South Delhi Municipal Corporation ke andar hai. South Delhi, they are saying that by March 2023. And then we have Ghazipur, the largest one. Ghazipur, they say that by September 2024, they'll flatten it. This happened after various complaints in NGT in 2019. Earlier in 2019, they dismissed the plan to cap, NGT dismissed the plan to cap the landfills. Cap the landfills was like covering the landfill. उसके ऊपर और कुछ नहीं डालेंगे एंड छोड़ दो. एनजीटी सेड दैट नो, if you only cap the landfill, all those issues of methane and fire would happen. Rainfall will lead to leaching, a lot of waste happening there. All the decomposition smelling would continue happening. So the NGT had called for following Indore model and going for bio-mining and bio-remediation. We have studied what bio-mining is, segregating things and taking out things. And bio-remediation also, the waste which is harmful, treat them with microorganisms to make them less harmful. Go for that mechanisms. So now these municipal bodies are working on these. Okay, so you may be asked a question ki Okhla kahan pe located hai? In Mumbai, mein, Kolkata, mein, Delhi, mein, you should be able to say that Okhla is located in Delhi. So you should know the name of these three landfill sites. Okay, now we have talked about what are the different ways in which solid waste is dealt with in India. Right? But what does the law say? Are there rules, regulations related to municipal solid waste in the country? If you'll go, in 2016, we came up with new set of rules. Solid Waste Management Rule 2016. This happened after 16 years. Earlier in 2000, we had solid waste management rules. It had certain limitations. It had certain shortcomings. To remove those shortcomings, to make the system, as per the current scenario, they came up with new set of rules, Municipal Solid Waste Rules 2016. So first, who comes with Municipal Solid Waste Rules? It is Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change. They came up with Municipal Solid Waste Rules. Second, what did they do? What are the key features of this Municipal Solid Waste Rules? First thing that they did was they expanded the scope of the rules. The 2000 rule, 2016 rule se pehle jo 2000 rule tha, solid waste rule, that was only applicable in municipal areas. Here they expanded the scope. They did not take it to rural areas, but other than municipal areas also, there are urban agglomerations, census towns, notified industrial township, areas which are under control of Indian Railways, airports, airbase, ports, harbors, defense establishments, SEZ, state and central government organization, places of pilgrims, religious and historically important sites. These are all the areas which were not earlier covered under or where municipal solid waste management rules 2000 were not applicable. Now, even in those areas, even in these areas, solid waste management rule 2016 would be applicable. So what is the first thing that they have done? They have expanded the scope of solid waste, this thing. Then second thing that they have called for is source segregation. They have made it mandatory to segregate waste into different categories. Ye organic waste hai, inorganic waste hai. And therefore you'll see that even in the morning when they come, waste collection people come, their vehicle is also divided into two parts. One for organic waste, one for solid waste, other for other kinds of waste. It's because it's mandatory. Now they do not segregate it. Just go in a packet, in a poly bag, you throw everything at one place. Segregation is not happening, but it is mandatory. So you'll have to have basic infrastructure for that. Then generators of the waste have also been given the responsibility to segregate waste into three streams: wet waste, dry waste, and domestic hazard waste. Wet waste, jo biodegradable wet waste honge. Dry waste, plastic, paper, metal, wood, etc. And then domestic hazard waste, those waste which may cause diseases like diapers, napkins, empty containers of cleaning agent, mosquito repellents, etc. They have to be separated into these three categories. And then it has to be handed over to authorities in different packets. It is mandatory now. Now, under these rules, there are focus on integration of waste pickers, rag pickers, etc. with the formal system. Open throwing or burning or burying of waste has been banned. User fee and spot fines related provisions. Say, for example, if you are found littering an area, if you are found non-segregating your waste, you may be fined. Then bulk and institutional generators ke liye bhi they have come up with certain norms. For example, you can understand who bulk or institutional generators of the waste would be. Hotels, which are organizing big events where thousands of people would come and eat, they'll generate a lot of waste. So they are directly responsible for segregation and sorting. Aisa nahi hai, like suppose there's a marriage hall which has seen thousand people attending. Now in the morning they'll say the municipality wale aake, they'll segregate the waste. No, they are responsible. They themselves are responsible for segregating the waste. So they have been made directly responsible for segregation and sorting the waste and manage it in partnership with local bodies. Similarly, gated communities, whose area is more than 5,000 square kilometer, they have to provide for facilities where waste segregation could happen into dry waste. And they have a special facility in the compound itself for dealing with waste. That is what they have done. Then biodegradable waste should be processed, treated. Those kind of things have been talked about. A new township and group housing societies should develop an in-house waste handling facility. Street vendors, they should have separate containers for different kinds of waste. Then developers of SEZ, industrial estate, industrial park, etc. should also earmark 5% of the total area which they are using for these purposes, waste treatment purposes. Then all manufacturers of disposable products, such as tin, glass, plastics, packaging, or brand owners who introduce such product in the market, should provide financial assistance to local authorities. So if I am, let's say, if I'm producing pickles and I'm packing them in plastic bags and supplying it in the market, I'm using those plastic because it's because of my product those plastic bags are being used in the market. That is my responsibility to provide some funds to local bodies. Because eventually local bodies would be the ones which will be taking care of this plastic. Then sanitary and napkins and diapers ke liye special rules likhe gaye the. They had said that the rules say that you should try to identify biodegradable products. Like, can sanitary napkins or diapers be made out of recyclable material, biodegradable material? And then with each of these sanitary napkins and diapers should go a pouch or wrapper. And these sanitary napkins or diapers should be packed in this pouch and wrappers and then thrown. And thrown nahi, aisa nahi gali mein fek doge, should be disposed of. Not just like that, along with other waste. Then all industrial units using fuel and located within 100 kilometers from a solid waste based RDF plant. RDF plant are those plants where solid waste would be burned to produce energy. So all the industrial units which are within 100 kilometers of RDF plant must be using 5% of their fuel requirement from these RDF plants. So basically, what is the idea? Idea is biofuel jaisa. In biofuel, what was happening? The government has mandated ki ethanol add kar do. In the same way, here government has mandated that you must take a part of your fuel, a part of your electricity from these RDF plants. Then non-recyclable wastes, which have calorific value of 1500 kilocalorie per kg, 1500 k calorie per kg, these should not be dumped. These should be burned to produce energy because they have high calorific value. If it's not recyclable, if it's recyclable, definitely a plastic recyclable hai to use recycle karo. But if it's not recyclable, do not just dump it. So high calorific value wale jo waste hai, you should use it for producing energy, you should use it for producing electricity. So high calorific waste shall be used for co-processing in cement or thermal power plants. Okay, so municipal solid waste rules 2016, sometimes UPSC may ask questions from it. So you should know about what the rules are. Okay, so this was solid waste and issues associated with solid waste. Now, let me see if there are any questions. Guys, is there any question that you want to ask? Nahin. Aur chat mein bhej dijiye if you need to ask anything. No one is asking anything. Fine. Let's go to plastic pollution. Plastic pollution. So प्लास्टिक व्हेन इट वाज फर्स्ट क्रिएटेड और रादर देन सेइंग व्हेन इट वाज फर्स्ट क्रिएटेड इवन टुडे इज वन ऑफ द मोस्ट यूजफुल थिंग्स लाइक इट हैज सिंप्लीफाइड आवर लाइफ लाइक एनीथिंग यू वांट टू गो एंड बाय सम मिल्क इन द मॉर्निंग इट कम्स इन अ प्लास्टिक बैग यू बाय अ पैकेट ऑफ ब्रेड इट कम्स इन अ प्लास्टिक बैग You go and buy six eggs, the shop owner will give you a plastic bag. You go and buy vegetables, you'll get it in a plastic bag. You order a chair, different components of chair would be wrapped in a plastic bag. You buy the shirt, you'll get this in a plastic bag. A lot of things that we wear, let's say the watch that I'm wearing, the specs that I'm wearing, plastic components may be used there. It's because plastic is cheap, easy to produce, hygienic, and resistant. It will not be like paper, wo itni aasani se phat nahi jayega. And thus, plastic is one of the most important manufactured thing. Plastic industries, again, manufacturing sector mein, is one of the most important ones. So since the 1950s, plastics production has outpaced production of everything else. Because whatever you are buying, think of now, you're buying some clothes. You bring it in some plastic, those clothes would be packed in some plastic things. So for whatever you're doing, most of the things would come in plastic. Ek bada plant bhi, machine bhi kharid rahe ho na, that will come wrapped in a plastic. Okay, so plastics is the most produced product in the world currently. Now, there are two kinds of plastics. By the way, this figure you may not be having in your notes. While revising things in the morning, I realized that I have not given you the differentiation between two, like thermoplastic and thermosets. So I have added it. So you just write it down. There are two kinds of plastic. One is thermoplastic. Other is thermoset. Now, what is thermoplastic? Thermoplastics are those plastics which, when heated, will melt. When cooled, will become solid. And thus, they can be given shapes again and again, again and again, again and again. You can melt them, give them a different shape. They'll cool down and take that shape, use it. Again melt them. Again, give them different shape. So those are thermoplastics. Thermoplastics are a family of plastics that can be melted when heated and hardened when cooled. There's thermoplastic. Now, basically with heat, thermoplastic, they get that plastic property. Okay. Then these characteristics which lend the material its name are reversible. That is, it can be reheated, reshaped and frozen repeatedly. Understood? Like, do I have to explain it? It's simple. Thermoplastic. Whereas thermoset is different. Thermoset, they undergo chemical change when heated. So when heated, they'll undergo chemical change and create a three-dimensional network. After this, these plastics cannot be remelted. These plastics cannot be reformed. So they have, after being heated, they have got into a set. They'll not get modified. You cannot, the thermoset plastics, you cannot reheat them and give them shape again. Whereas to thermoplastics, you could have done. So there are examples of thermosets like urea formaldehyde, vinyl ester, epoxy resin, phenolic resins, polyurethane, etc. These are different examples of thermosets. Whereas thermoplastics mein, the polyethylene, polypropylene, then low density polyethylene, all these are examples of thermoplastics. Okay, thermoplastics and thermosets. The name will tell you the difference. Thermoplastics. With heat, the thing melts and gets its plastic property. Thermoset. With heat, some chemical change will take place and now a 3D structure would be formed. Now you won't be able to modify it. Difference between thermoplastic and thermoset. तो एज वी वर सेइंग प्लास्टिक्स आर वन ऑफ द मोस्ट कॉमनली यूज्ड मटेरियल इन द वर्ल्ड. सो फार 1950s से अभी तक बिलियंस ऑफ टन्स ऑफ प्लास्टिक्स हैव बीन प्रोड्यूस्ड. एज पर ग्लोबल प्लास्टिक प्रोडक्शन बाय इंडस्ट्री सेक्टर 2015 रिपोर्ट, एवरी ईयर द वर्ल्ड प्रोड्यूसेस अराउंड 400 मिलियन टन्स ऑफ प्लास्टिक. वी प्रोड्यूस अराउंड 400 मिलियन टन्स ऑफ प्लास्टिक एंड इन विच इंडस्ट्रीज आर दे यूज्ड? सबसे ज्यादा पैकेजिंग. That you can understand, even a packet of tea, a packet of coffee, a pack, anything that you are buying, it comes packed in plastics. So 36% of it is used for in packaging. Then there are other areas, textiles. I was telling you, you buy a t-shirt, that will also come there, and some plastic may also be used in textiles, in making textiles. Right, that is another thing. Building and construction, these gates, some plastic component may have been used. In your windows, of plastic components may have been used. Which are transportation, vehicles and all, plastic components are used there. Industrial machinery, textiles, others. A lot of things are there. So, सबसे ज़्यादा packaging में use हो रहा है. Now, how? So, we are using a lot of plastics. We are producing around 400 million tons of plastic every year. In 2015, we are producing this much of plastic. Now. How is this plastic disposed of? So far, from around 1950s, we have produced 9 billion tons of plastic. Now, this number may have gone up. This study was in the year 2015. Till 2015, we had produced 9 billion tons of plastic. 9 billion, not million, please note that. 9 billion tons of plastic. We have produced so far. Out of that, only 9% have been recycled. Itna humne produce kiya, usme se 9% is again went for reuse. 12% was incinerated, was burned. But remaining 79%. If you look at this bottle, the cap ka size, 9% was used for recycling. 12% was burned, but another 79% plastic has got into environment. It has got into environment. It is in the oceans, it is in the landfills, it is on the ground, it is in our bodies. Because if it's in the water, we're consuming water, we're also taking plastic. If it's in our food, when we're consuming food, it's in our body. So remaining 79% of plastic we have added to the nature. Now, plastic is not something natural. Plastic is something which is man-made. So in nature, we have added so much of man-made things. Now, India produces 10 million tons of plastic every year. Of that, 5 billion tons is rendered waste every year. Now, all the plastic that you produce in that year would not become waste in that very year. This air conditioner, it has used plastic. This plastic, let's say, was produced in 2017. It did not become waste then and there only. It will become waste sometimes later. It may be recycled also. So, all the plastic that we produced, 5 million tons is wasted, gets wasted every year. Now, in general, we are wasting so much of plastic, we are adding so much of plastic in nature. Studies have shown, World Wildlife Foundation ne 2019 mein ek estimate lagaya tha ki average human being may be ingesting as much as 5 grams of plastic every week. In your body, around 5 grams of plastic is entering every week. Average. India mein pollution level jyada hai. You may be having more of those. And sometimes, I do not know how many of you have seen this, but sometimes when you see dead animals, like in our hometown, Bhiwadi, to wahan pe a lot of the people from Gujar community live, so they have these animals, cows and all, cows, buffaloes and all. तो व्हेन दीज एनिमल्स डाई दे जस्ट सम पीपल जस्ट डिस्पोज देम ऑफ इन सम आइसोलेटेड लोकेशंस. तो अगर आप उस एरिया से गुजरोगे तो कई बार यू विल बी एबल टू सी इनसाइड ऑफ द एनिमल, और व्हेन द होल एनिमल हैज बीन डिकम्पोज्ड देन यू विल सी दैट एक इतना बड़ा प्लास्टिक का कंपोनेंट वहां रह गया है. लाइक दिस एनिमल व्हाइल ईटिंग वेजिटेबल व्हाइल ईटिंग एवरीथिंग kept on ingesting plastic, and after the animal dies, everything gets decomposed. It is the plastic that you'll be able to see. And if you walk along that road daily, because if you walk along that road daily, you would slowly see decomposition taking place. पहले वो पूरा dead body पड़ा है, 10 दिन बाद वो dead body में और खराब हो जाएगा वो सब. इवेंचुअली यू विल सी प्लास्टिक इमर्जिंग फ्रॉम देयर. तो इवन एनिमल्स आर कंज्यूमिंग सो मच ऑफ प्लास्टिक. इट्स नॉट ओनली ह्यूमंस दैट वी, इट्स नॉट ओनली अस हु आर, वी आर इनडायरेक्टली कंज्यूमिंग इट, नो वन इज फोर्सिंग अस, बट दे आर नॉट स्मार्ट इनफ टू अंडरस्टैंड दैट दिस प्लास्टिक वुड बी हार्मफुल, दे जस्ट टेक इट इन. सो मेनी, सो मच ऑफ प्लास्टिक विच वी हैव पुट इन नेचर इज गेटिंग इन टू आर बॉडी ऑल्सो. ओके, one of the most bad kind of plastic is this single use plastic. For example, the straw that you use for having juice, you use that straw. Now that is single use, after that you throw it away, right? Sometimes you go with your loved ones, so the other person may also use the same straw pyar dikhane ke liye, but that is still single use. Aap use leke ghar nahi jate ho, chalo kal bhi isi straw se piyenge. और सिगरेट बड्स, एक सिगरेट का बड आपने यूज किया, देखो मग दैट यू यूज इन योर होम्स दैट इज नॉट सिंगल यूज प्लास्टिक, दैट यू विल कीप यूजिंग अगेन एंड अगेन, बट अ लॉट ऑफ प्लास्टिक इज यूज्ड ओनली वंस, दैट इज सिंगल यूज प्लास्टिक, एंड दोज आर रियली बिकमिंग प्रॉब्लम्स बिकॉज एवरी डे सम स्ट्रॉ विल बी गेटिंग इन टू द डस्टबिन. एवरी डे इवन यू बाय द मिल्क पैकेट, दैट मिल्क पैकेट का जो प्लास्टिक कवर, दैट सिंगल यूज प्लास्टिक. So that is adding to a lot of waste in nature. A mug may not be adding that much waste. You'd buy a mug in 2 years. You'll use it for many days. I haven't bought a mug in 5-6 years because I don't remember buying it. Abhi main soch raha hu ki mug, where do we use mugs? I do not know. So that is not a problem. These plastics are a problem. Food packaging mein, bottles mein, straws mein, this is something which is a big problem. So there was a talk going on. Should we do away with single-use plastic? Should we ban single-use plastic? Idea was, yes, it will reduce the amount of plastic which is getting into the nature, but we could not do it because there's no alternative. No easy alternative. Think, tomorrow we ban all these plastics. How would your milk be supplied to you? Tetra pack would be very expensive. It also has some certain plastic in it. How would you get your milk? How would you go and buy your vegetables? Like, not everything can be carried in a jute bag. So we have not banned it, but Prime Minister Modi in 2019 had said that we'll phase out single-use plastic by 2022. तो स्ट्रॉ, सम ईटेबल स्ट्रॉ काइंड ऑफ थिंग्स हैव टू बी क्रिएटेड. आप जूस पियो उसके बाद स्ट्रॉ भी खा जाओ. सम स्टार्च और यूजिंग सम अदर मैकेनिज्म्स, दे मे हैव टू बी क्रिएटेड. ओके, सो प्लास्टिक, सो फार वी हैव सीन डिफरेंट टू ब्रॉड टाइप्स ऑफ प्लास्टिक्स, हाउ मच ऑफ प्लास्टिक्स आर वी प्रोड्यूसिंग, हाउ मच ऑफ इट इज गेटिंग इन नेचर. लाइक इन इंडिया आउट ऑफ 10 मिलियन टन व्हिच इज बीइंग प्रोड्यूस्ड एवरी ईयर, 5 मिलियन टन इज गेटिंग इनटू एनवायरमेंट ऑफ द वर्ल्ड. Almost 80% of the plastic which has been produced so far has got into environment. Okay, so before we get into harmful effects of plastic, please understand something called microplastics. What is microplastic? Now, one key feature of plastic because of which it has become a curse for us is that it is non-biodegradable. It is non-biodegradable, right? Microorganisms cannot degrade it very quickly. It will take thousands or thousands and thousands of years for it to degrade. This is a key feature. Now, because of this key feature, what happens is when you throw a plastic, that plastic will not be biodegraded. Because of physical force and all, it may break into smaller pieces, smaller and smaller pieces, but it would still remain plastic. So when you throw a packet of plastic into the ocean, ocean waves and all, physical force is being applied. So it cannot withstand physical force, so break ho jayega. It will keep breaking into smaller and smaller pieces, but it will remain plastic. These smaller and smaller, jo dikh bhi nahi rahe honge aapke paani mein, pieces of plastics are called microplastics. And microplastics are much bigger problem. Why? Because wo dikh bhi nahi rahe hote. People keep consuming it. People keep, like animals there may keep on consuming these microplastics. They are not even recognizing it. A packet of plastic, you can clean it. How would you clean microplastics? This is not even visible. Okay, it's because if they are non-biodegradable, concerns come. Now, what are the harmful impacts of plastics? In harmful impact, first comes the environmental impact. In environmental impact, you can understand that they contaminate soil, they contaminate water. Because plastics do contain certain carcinogenic things and thus are harmful, thus create this problem. Then, once they get into environment, they may be ingested by animals, they may choke animals, they may entangle living organisms. For example, you may have seen turtles getting entangled in plastic nets and all. Now, when they get entangled, when they are not able to move, they'll die. So those issues are also creating. Then these microplastics, which are in the oceans, we may think that chalo dusre janwar kha rahe hain. But dusre fish, when they are consuming those microplastics, and when we consume that fish, it's coming in our food chain also, and is thus harming us also. That is one concern. Then there are health and social impact. How? Health, you can understand, is carcinogenic, but it also leads to welfare loss. There are social impact also. Why? Think of parks where people could have gone and played, field where people could have gone and played. There, because of dumping of this plastic waste, it has become unhygienic, it has become unusable. Then sewage blocking. Plastics are one of the major reasons, because they do not biodegrade. So when they get into the sewage, they block the water. They block the flow of water. This sewage blocking leads to water becoming stagnant, mosquitoes breeding there, dengue, malaria. These are all other impacts that we have. Okay, then there are economic impacts. Tourism sector suffers if the city is dirty because of plastic. Visually, it will not be an appealing thing. Then there would, in economic impact, also understand that future cost of plastic pollution is huge. Chahe wo health ke perspective se ho, chahe wo tourism ke perspective se ho, chahe wo environmental damages that we are creating, uske perspective se ho. Okay, then it also exacerbates disasters like floods. Urban floods mein congestion becomes a major factor. Rivers also get blocked by a lot of plastic, stagnant plastic waste. Rivers overflow, causing floods. Then even the biodegradable plastics, some plastics which are being developed in recent years are called biodegradable. They are biodegradable as they can degrade at temperatures of around 50 degrees Celsius. But in nature, do we have temperatures above 50 degrees Celsius? At very rare places, we have temperatures above 50 degrees Celsius. In ocean, will we ever have a temperature above 50 degrees Celsius? No. In ocean, there's not a single place in ocean where we'll have temperature more than 50 degrees Celsius. So when even these so-called biodegradable plastics, which are being made out of starch, which are being made out of cassava roots or sugarcane and or anything else, these plastics may be biodegradable, but these plastics will keep blocking rivers, will keep getting ingested by animals, will keep converting into smaller and smaller pieces called microplastics. Okay. क्लैरिटी, तो प्लास्टिक्स आर प्रॉब्लमैटिक. नाउ इंडिया हैव ऑल्सो कम अप विथ प्लास्टिक वेस्ट मैनेजमेंट रूल्स. जैसे भी सॉलिड वेस्ट मैनेजमेंट रूल्स था, ऐसे वी केम अप विथ प्लास्टिक वेस्ट मैनेजमेंट रूल इन 2016 एंड दिस रूल्स वर ऑल्सो अमेंडेड इन 2018 अगेन. तो वील टॉक अबाउट द अमेंडमेंट ऑल्सो. तो वॉट की चेंजेस डिड वी ब्रिंग इन द प्लास्टिक वेस्ट मैनेजमेंट रूल. फर्स्ट थिंग दैट वी डिड वॉज वी इंक्रीज द मिनिमम थिकनेस ऑफ द प्लास्टिक विच इज अलाउड. तो कैरी बैग्स शुड हैव अ मिनिमम थिकनेस ऑफ 50 माइक्रोमीटर्स नाउ. Earlier, the minimum thickness of up to 40 micrometers was allowed. So, thickness of the plastic has been increased. Minimum thickness of the plastic has been increased. Similarly, plastic sheets, they should have a thickness of 50 micrometers. So, what we see here is thickness of plastic bags has been increased. Why would this be so? Why would we increase thickness of plastic bags? Minimum thickness of plastic bags. One, it increases the cost. Thicker the plastic bag, more plastic would have been used. It increases the cost. If it increases the cost, it reduces its use. Second, because it is increasing the thickness, now, and because the cost has increased, there would be more chances that rag picker would be picking it. Because it has more value. If the plastic is thicker, it has more value. There would be higher chances that rag picker would be picking it. Then this plastic will be less mobile. When you throw the plastic bags in the environment around you, they'll be less mobile. They'll fly to less distances and thus would not be able to pollute larger areas. Then think of animals consuming plastic. Thicker plastic, slightly thicker plastic, animals would also not be consuming it that easily. बहुत पतला सा रहता है, they consume it. So these are certain advantages of increasing the thickness of plastics. समझ में आ रही है बात? ये it's not mentioned, I have not written down the reasons. So please write it down in your notes, if you have printed notes in front of you, that one, cost increase. Cost increase was one reason because of which this would happen. Then second was rag picker, preference of rag pickers. So recycling aasan ho jati hai, easy ho jati hai. Less mobile. And fourth, less chances of being consumed by animals. Less mobile and then less chances of being consumed by animals. Less mobile and less chances of being consumed by animals. Okay. Understood? Why increasing the thickness? Generally, I have seen questions in the state PSC also and otherwise also in practice questions also. Most of the questions are related to what has happened. We have increased the thickness, minimum thickness of plastic bags and plastic sheets to 50 micrometers. But reasons generally, log nahi soch rahe, you should also know the reason. Second important thing is that has happened in the 2016 rules. Now, plastic waste management rules are also applicable in rural areas. Earlier, it was only applicable in urban areas. जिससे पहले 2000 वाले रूल्स थे, those were only applicable in urban areas. But from 2016, plastic waste management rules. So whatever conditions would be set in by these rules, even the panchayati raj institutions will have to follow, the local bodies there, local bodies in rural areas will have to follow these conditions. ये भी understood है. Third, by the way, please note, solid waste management rules, they are still not applicable in rural areas. Are solid waste management rules applicable in rural areas? No, they're still not applicable in rural areas. They have been expanded beyond municipal areas, but they're still not applicable in rural areas. Plastic waste management rules are applicable in rural areas as well. Then, phasing out of non-reusable multi-layered plastic. Multi-layered plastics, there are particular type of plastics. If they are non-reusable, if you cannot use it again and again, do away with it, phase it out. This was another thing that has been provided for here. Then it introduces the concept of extended producer responsibility. This is important. This concept of extended producer responsibility is important. What is the meaning of extended producer responsibility? Let's first understand this. See, I'm the producer of, let's say, milk. Don't assume ki main gaay hoon aur doodh deta hoon. I have a company which is collecting milk from farmers and then packaging it and supplying it, right? Someone has asked a question. Sir, if a statement comes that even biodegradable plastic can cause hypoxia, will that be a correct statement? Hypoxia is less oxygen availability. How would plastic cause hypoxia? Acha, covering the surface. Yes, Upmanyu, if biodegradable plastics are also there in the lake, they'll cover the surface of the lake and reduce the photosynthesis happening. So that may cause hypoxia, but may hoga, not necessarily. Okay, coming back to milk producer. Let's say I have a factory where I'm producing milk, and milk are being packed in the plastic bags. Milk is being packed in plastic bags. I'm the producer. But this plastic bags gets into different households. From here it may go to different shops. From those shops it may go to different households. I consume this milk, and then the waste bag gets into the dustbin. It goes to municipality. Municipality people, they collect it and then they dispose it. This is generally that happens. Now, extended producer responsibility kya hai? I was the producer. Extended producer responsibility basically extends the responsibility of taking care of this plastic to the producer. Till now, who took care of the responsibility? Municipality took care of the responsibility. They're saying that no, you also take care of the responsibility. When you are producing the plastic, you take care of the responsibility of that plastic. Recycling it, recovering it, ensuring that it's not getting into the environment. This is extended producer responsibility. Extended producer responsibility was first introduced in India in 2012 for the management of electronic waste. So let's say the Samsung is producing a phone. Their plastic is being used. So for e-waste, electronic waste, EPR was first introduced in India in 2012. It has in 2016 been extended to plastic waste also. EPR has been extended to plastic waste also. In 2019, in preliminary examination, there was a question. Ki extended producer responsibility was introduced in India when? Or they had given extended producer responsibility. EPR, nahi, EPR was introduced for the first time. Ye pucha tha. तो उसमें एक तो वन ऑफ द स्टेटमेंट वाज कि 2012 में ई वेस्ट के लिए था, ऐसा कुछ था. तो वन ऑफ द क्वेश्चन होता है, ईपीआर वाज फर्स्ट इंट्रोड्यूस्ड इन इंडिया फॉर ई वेस्ट इन 2012, बट हियर वी आर टॉकिंग अबाउट ईपीआर एक्सटेंडेड प्रोड्यूसर रिस्पांसिबिलिटी बीन एक्सटेंडेड टू प्लास्टिक मैन्युफैक्चरर्स आफ्टर द नोटिफिकेशन ऑफ पीडब्ल्यूएमआर 2016. मैन्युफैक्चरर्स प्रोड्यूसर्स एंड ऑल, it has been extended to them. So, jo milk producer hai, uski bhi responsibility hai. So, we'll talk about how. Like, how am I supposed to ensure that har ghar mein jo plastic use ho raha hai, I get it back. There are different mechanisms which have been suggested. We'll talk about that. But plastic waste management rules we're talking about. One thing that we did was we increased the thickness. Second, we extended these rules to rural areas. Third, we non-reusable multi-layered plastic has to be phased out. And fourth, introduction of extended producer responsibility. So for plastic waste, extended producer responsibility was introduced for the first time here. Then shopkeepers and vendors, they have to use plastic bags, but for using plastic bags, they have to register with the authorities. And then they can only use those plastic bags which have been properly labeled and marked for use. Otherwise, without labeling, if they're using plastic bags without labeling, then who produced that plastic bag? Is that plastic bag having minimum thickness of 50 micrometers? How would you know that? So only those plastic bags are allowed now which are properly labeled. But you would see that non-labeled plastic bags are also being used. They're all in violation of these norms. So your vegetable vendors, when they're using those transparent non-labeled plastic bags, they're actually violating these norms. So illegally wo plastic bags produce bhi ho rahe hain, they're still not following the 50 micrometers ka norm, and they're using it. If you go to more and all those places, food bazaar, so the plastic bag that they give you, wahan pe labeling wagaira rehti hai, where you put in vegetables and weight. Right? Some genuine shopkeepers, they'll give you plastic bags which are properly labeled. But most of the people working in unorganized sector are still using the non-labeled ones. Then urban local bodies and panchayats. Again, note, why panchayats? Because it has been extended to rural areas also. They have been given the responsibility of establishing and operating waste management system. Land department has been given the responsibility that they will allocate land for establishing of these waste management facilities, and plastic wastage or gainful uses that will be promoted in things like road construction, waste to oil conversion, and so on. These were key changes that were made in 2018 norms. Now, in 2016 norms, in 2018 amendments were done. What amendments have been done in these rules? First, jo multi-layered plastic, non-reusable multi-layered plastic had to be phased out, right? They had to be phased out. Now this phasing out has been extended to other kinds of multi-layered plastic also. Which kinds of multi-layered plastics? Plastics which are non-recyclable. So they can be reused but not recycled. So earlier non-recyclable plastics could be used. Reusable ones could be used, but even that has to be phased out. Non-energy recoverable, or those plastics which do not have any alternatives, which do not have any alternate use, those have to be phased out. Then a central pollution control board will create a centralized registration system for the registration of producers, importers, brand owners who contribute to plastic waste. And so centralized registration system will simplify the registration process. Abhi every state level pe aapka, if you had a registration system for people who are producing plastic waste or who are responsible for plastic waste, this may have been complicated. A national registry would be there for people who are working in, for companies which may be working in two different states. So where do they register it? They'll register at national registry. And one more key change that was done in 2018, not very important now, was that earlier vendors, shopkeepers who were going to use plastic, they were supposed to pay 4,000 rupees a month to the municipality. So total 48,000 rupees per year they were supposed to pay. Like, why would a shopkeeper, a vegetable vendor do that? This was considered an harassment, and thus it was done away in the 2018 amendment. So these amendments, not very important, but jo core cheez humne padhi hai, plastic waste management rule 2016, you should always be able to answer preliminary examination question related to it, but also the mains examination ones. Always have 5 things on your tips related to plastic waste management rules, so that in exam, even if you are asked to critically analyze plastic waste management rule, briefly you will first be able to answer what is given in plastic waste management rules. Okay, now in 2020, in June 2020, a draft proposal aaya hai on how draft EPR has been released. EPR guidelines have been released. So how extended producer responsibility would be implemented? In what different ways extended producer responsibility would be implemented? This as a draft proposal which came in June 2020. Plastic waste ke liye extended producer responsibility. I gave you that example, no? Milk producer, eventually milk goes to the domestic homes. Ab main kya karu? Main mar jaun? In case mein, how do I contribute? How do I make this producer responsible? So three models have been suggested in the draft rules which they have come up with. One is, just a second. Three models have been suggested. One is fee-based mechanism. where you pay a fee. So I'm the milk producer who's using a lot of these plastic bags. I'll pay some fee for use of that plastic bag. So center will create, government will create a central corpus. And in that, the plastic producers could pay some fee, and that money would be used by municipalities and all for taking care of that plastic. That is fee-based mechanism, where you do not actually have to do anything. You just pay the money and we'll get the work done. Then there is buying credit from a system. What is buying credit? If you want to use 100 kg of plastic, you buy credit related for that 100 kg of plastic from a system that would be established to offset the plastic waste management, plastic waste they generate. So initially you have credit buy, rather than paying fee, you can buy credit also, or you set up your own producer responsibility organization or be part of some producer responsibility organization. What is this producer responsibility organization? See, ab Amul ka kaam hai doodh bechna, dahi bechna and all, like wahi same cheez bechna. Now they are not experts in waste recycling, recovery and all. So unke upar responsibility dalna is not correct, not fine. Allow them to form an organization, separate organization called producer responsibility organization. That producer responsibility organization will be funded by them and all, and it would be the one which would be primarily responsible for managing post-consumer plastic waste recovery. So three different: fee-based mechanism, credit-based mechanism, and producer responsibility organization. Either you can participate in that producer responsibility organization yourself, or you can pay for the creation of this producer responsibility organization. Fine. So now please note that this is still a draft proposal, but I wanted you to understand how EPR could be implemented, how extended producer responsibility could be implemented. Then manufacturers have also been given certain responsibilities. For example, 5 years to, they have been given 5 years to achieve waste management targets. That is by, they will start with 30% and eventually move to 90% in the fifth year after the rules are notified. So these are still draft rules. So when rules get notified, let's say 2021 mein rules get notified, then by 2026, they should be able to manage 90% of their waste. Then all stakeholders, these stakeholders would include producers, will include municipal bodies, will include government, will include consumers, recyclers, and so on. The, all of them, recyclers, producers, all those, they have to be registered with a new national registry through an online portal. So don't worry about all these things in more in a lot of detail. Just the three ways in which EPR is planned to be implemented. Please know that. Please understand that. Three ways in which EPR is planned to be implemented. You should be able to answer that. Okay, now because it's draft, we are not getting into the details of each of those mechanisms, but we should know about it. Road made of plastic waste. Roads made of plastic waste. Abhi ye news mein tha, July 2021, 2-3 days back only, I had sent this PIB article. So here, Ministry of Road Transport and Highways have issued guidelines for use of plastic waste in road construction. Now, to understand how would we use plastic waste in road construction, can you imagine this? Have you seen road construction happening? Forget the cemented roads, but the traditional roads, how are they made? Okay. Eventually, what do they use? Tar. We call it tar. You say you call it tar. Bhavani is writing damar. Damar. That's called damar. Okay. So they use that black thing at the top of it. Just imagine this. Can we add some plastic? Plastic bhi melt ho jayega, usme mix ho jayega. And plastic also gives you that strength. Yes, we'll be able to use some of the plastic in it. Right. So to promote the use of plastic material in road construction, recently government, Ministry of Road Transport and Highways have come up with certain guidelines. Ankit Dhaya is like, Praveen Chaudhary is writing tar. अंकित दहिया इज राइटिंग टारकोल. यस यस ऑल दोस थिंग्स आर सेम. तो रिसेंटली टू प्रमोट यूज ऑफ प्लास्टिक वेस्ट इन दी रोड कंस्ट्रक्शन गाइडलाइंस हैव कम. नाउ व्हाई वुड वी नीड गाइडलाइंस, बिकॉज अदरवाइज द रोड कंस्ट्रक्टर्स वुड नॉट बी रेडी. जैसे हम बोलते हैं ना इतना ये अल्कोहल बोल रहा हूं मैं सॉरी इतना बायोफ्यूल डालो अपने पेट्रोल में, ओनली देन दे हैव ओनली व्हेन इट इज मैंडेटरी पीपल डू इट. इन द सेम वे व्हाट दे हैव डन इज दे हैव मेड इट मैंडेटरी टू यूज प्लास्टिक इन पीरियोडिक रिन्यूअल कोट ऑफ द पेवमेंट ऑफ नेशनल हाईवेज. तो नेशनल हाईवेज जो पेवमेंट है उसका जो पीरियोडिक रिन्यूअल होगा उसमें यूज ऑफ प्लास्टिक वेस्ट इज मैंडेटरी. सिमिलरली वियरिंग कोर्स ऑफ सर्विस रोड. तो व्हाट इज वियरिंग कोर्स डू यू अंडरस्टैंड. तो रोड्स आर कंस्ट्रक्टेड इन डिफरेंट लेयर्स. फर्स्ट दिल डिग समथिंग, दिल एड सम कॉन्क्रीट देयर, दिल कीप हिटिंग दैट कॉन्क्रीट टू फिट इन इट, देन दिल एड अनदर लेयर ऑन इट. जो उसमें टॉप लेयर होता है दैट इज वियरिंग कोर्स. टॉप लेयर के ऊपर एक और पतला सा लेयर हो सकता है, बट जनरली द लेयर विच बियर्स द बर्डन इज दिस वेयरिंग कोर्स. तो फॉर मेकिंग दिस वेयरिंग कोर्स ऑफ सर्विस रोड्स विच आर लोकेटेड विद इन 50 किलोमीटर्स ऑफ अर्बन एरियाज विच हैव पॉपुलेशन ऑफ एटलीस्ट 5 lakh और मोर. तो अंडरस्टैंड दिस वे, इफ दिस इज अ सिटी हुज पॉपुलेशन इज 5 lakh और मोर, तो विद इन 50 किलोमीटर्स ऑफ इट इफ एनी रोड इज बींग कंस्ट्रक्टेड देन यूज ऑफ प्लास्टिक हैज बीन मेड मैंडेटरी. The two places use of plastic has been made mandatory. One for national highways for their renewal coat of the pavement, and for roads around cities. Roads in a city where population is 5 lakh. In a city where population is 5 lakh, within 50 kilometer of that city, if some road is being constructed, their wearing coat should be using plastic waste. Do jagah plastic waste has been made mandatory. In fact, Indian Road Congress have also come up with guidelines for the use of waste plastic in hot bituminous mixes for wearing course. Understood this? Hot bituminous mixture. Isme how plastic would be used? Uske liye Indian Road Congress have also come up with certain guidelines. Okay, so far 703 km length of national highways have been constructed using plastic waste. More may be constructed. In July 2021, abhi. This month only, this set of guidelines had come related to plastic waste. So see, आपका update अभी जुलाई तक का हो गया है. Your update of current affairs for environment has happened till July. From next week, we are starting with polity and governance. So polity governance में भी जो update है, we'll do. On Fridays, we'll keep updating previous things. So we'll start with science and technology. So next Friday, हम science and technology का जो भी update होगा वो करेंगे. On Saturday, Sunday, we'll keep doing polity governance. तो मोर और लेस आर सिलेबस वुड बी डन. पॉलिटी गवर्नेंस इज समथिंग दैट इज पेंडिंग प्राइमरली बड़े लो चीजों में, एंड अपडेट्स आर पेंडिंग. तो अपडेट्स आई विल डू, एंड देन पॉलिटी गवर्नेंस वंस वो सैटिस्फैक्ट्री लेवल पे हो जाता है फिर हम आगे कुछ करेंगे. ओके, एंड आई एम सॉरी मैं कल किसी पे गुस्सा हो गया था ग्रुप में. फिर से वो सेम, दे कीप रिपीटिंग द सेम थिंग अगेन एंड अगेन. व्हेन द कोर्स वुड गेट कंप्लीटेड, इट वुड गेट कंप्लीटेड ऑन 10th ऑफ सेप्टेंबर, बिकॉज वी हैव टू कंप्लीट न्यूज़पेपर्स टिल 10th ऑफ सेप्टेंबर. Your exam is on 10th of October. So we'll complete everything till 10th of September for your preliminary examination. That's why it will get completed by 10th of September. एक आधा वीक आगे होगा, because 10th of September तक का न्यूज कवर करने के लिए हमें एक वीक और क्लास लेना पड़ सकता है. तो जिस दिन वो जो भी सैटरडे संडे आएगा, will not extend it beyond that. Okay, core current affairs will not be extended beyond that. हमारा हो जाएगा. उसके बाद यू वुड रिक्वेस्ट मी कि सर ज्योग्राफी पढ़ा दो, हिस्ट्री पढ़ा दो. आई कैन डू दैट. उससे पहले भी यू विल रिक्वेस्ट मी, आई विल डू दैट. बट आफ्टर दी एटलीस्ट पॉलिटी गवर्नेंस थिंग इज डन, पॉलिटी गवर्नेंस में स्कीम्स वगैरह इज डन, आफ्टर दैट आई विल टेक ऑल द रिक्वेस्ट. एंशिएंट इंडिया, मेडिवल इंडिया, कल्चर, वॉट एवर यू वुड वॉन्ट, विल डू दैट. ओके, नाउ या रोड कंस्ट्रक्शन में प्लास्टिक का यूज डन. देर आर सम इंटरनेशनल एफर्ट्स रिलेटेड टू प्लास्टिक पोल्यूशन. Just read them once. They were not in news like recently only. Some of them were in news in last 1 year, but even 2-3 year old things I have done it here. For example, to increase awareness related to plastic pollution, in the year 2018 World Environment Day had theme Beat Plastic Pollution. Then in 2019, the European Union Parliament, we have covered European Union. Who will name all the countries of European Union? मैंने उस टाइम क्लास में याद करवाया था एकदम सिस्टमैटिकली. Who will name it? All the countries of European Union. मैं उसे ट्रीट पे लेके जाऊंगा. अभी देखो मुझे दिख रहा है प्रज्ञा गूगल करने लगी. अभी गूगल करके बताती नहीं मजाक कर रहा हूं. किसी को याद नहीं है यार. थोड़ा मैप वैप में ना इट विल बी हेल्पफुल. इंटरेस्टिंग होता है ना. तो नीचे से शुरू करो पोर्तुगल स्पेन ऊपर जाओ यूके. इट वुड बी इजी. अब यूके नहीं है भाई दबे. आई एम सॉरी आयरलैंड है. ओके तो ट्राई टू कीप दैट इन योर माइंड. तो व्हाइल टीचिंग यूरोपियन यूनियन वी हैड सेड दैट यूरोपियन यूनियन हैज यूरोपियन कमीशन यूरोपियन पार्लियामेंट राइट. तो यूरोपियन पार्लियामेंट इन 2019 पास्ड अ लॉ बैनिंग 10 सिंगल यूज प्लास्टिक प्रोडक्ट्स इन यूरोपियन यूनियन. EU में 10 single use plastic products were banned. The law was passed in 2019, but it was supposed to become applicable from 2021. So from 3rd of July this month, this law which was passed in 2019 have come into force. So the measure has taken effect from 2021. From 3rd July 2021, it has come into force. What are the measures? Single-use plastics like straws, forks, knives, cotton buds, plates, balloon sticks, food and beverage containers made up of expanded polystyrene and all products made up of oxo-degradable plastics, etc. Oxo-degradable ones are also banned. What is this oxo-degradable? These are those the so-called biodegradable plastics. Actually, no, oxo-degradable are not those. Oxo-degradable are those plastics which can break easily. They're not biodegradable, but can break easily into smaller pieces. So they'll not end up blocking your sewage. But wo smaller and smaller pieces may be harmful. Rahenge. They'll still remain harmful in smaller and smaller pieces. Those are oxo-degradable plastics. So all products which are made out of polystyrene और दीज ऑक्सो बायोडिग्रेडेबल प्लास्टिक उसके सिंगल यूज प्रोडक्ट्स 10 सिंगल यूज प्रोडक्ट्स हैव बीन बैंड. देन कंट्रीज हैव आल्सो बीन रिक्वेस्टेड टू वॉलंटरली विदड्रॉ अदर सिंगल यूज प्लास्टिक. 10 सिंगल यूज प्लास्टिक्स हैव बीन बैंड. 10 सिंगल यूज प्लास्टिक प्रोडक्ट्स हैव बीन बैंड बट अदर सिंगल यूज प्लास्टिक्स ऑल्सो वॉलंटरली कंट्रीज कैन टेक स्टेप्स टू डू अवे विद इट देयर. देन बाय 2029. Please note, here we have not banned plastic bottles. European Union has not banned plastic bottles. But they have said that by 2019, EU countries will collect and recycle 90% of the plastic bottles. Then plastic bottles will have at least 25% of the recycled content by 2025, which will increase 30% by 2030. Finally, tobacco companies. In Europe, if you'll go, like Switzerland is a very beautiful city, very beautiful country. But smoking is something very common there. And one key thing that you'll see all around Europe will be the buds. Smoking ke baad jo wo cottonish cheez reh jati hai na. Those lying around in the whole city, and a lot of those are also made up of plastics. They add to plastic pollution in Europe. So here it has been said that tobacco companies will be required to cover the cost of public collection of cigarette stumps. It is who extended producer responsibility. You, the tobacco companies, you pay for the cost of public collection of cigarette stumps, which are the second most littered single-use plastic. Likewise, manufacturers of fishing gears will have to bear the cost of net lost in the sea. So net fishing gears mein jo sea mein jo loss ja raha hai, uska bhi cost unhe dena padega. Then to implement this, because it was passed by EU Parliament, to implement this on ground, member countries have come up with their own laws, and from 3rd of July 2021, it is in force. fine, banning of single use plastic. Then there are some other efforts. For example, Clean Sea Campaign hai, UN Environment ka. Similarly, Stockholm Convention related to POPs. We have studied that. So these plastics also contain certain persistent organic pollutants. And thus, Stockholm Convention also contributes there. Honolulu strategy by UNEP aimed at reducing marine debris. Marine debris, debris in oceans and all. They contain plastic. Usse deal karne ke liye Honolulu strategy hai UNEP ka. So another international effort to deal with plastic pollution. Then Alliance to End Plastic Waste. It's a NGO which was set, a not-for-profit organization which was set up in January 2019 dealing with plastic issues. So these are certain international efforts dealing with plastic pollution. You do not have to get into details of everything, but you should know that Honolulu strategy is for marine debris. Marine debris mein plastic pollution would also be there. Fine. Now, there's another thing that you should know. What is plastic rust? Look at this image. The stone. This is a stone piece. Samundar ke bagal mein. Now, our oceans have a lot of plastic. So those plastics will keep hitting with waves. Those plastic things will keep hitting this rock. In the process, over a period, rust from that plastic will get deposited on these rocks. This is plastic rust. Rust, generally we talk about rust from the perspective of iron. But what is plastic rust? It's a new type of plastic pollution. It is essentially flecks of crusty blue and white plastic hardened onto rocky surface where the land and sea meet. So chemical analysis of the crust revealed that they were made up of polyethylene, an extremely common plastic often used in single used containers. This is another plastic rust, is another type of plastic pollution. Okay, so this was everything related to plastic pollution. Now let's go to e-waste. So before we go to e-waste, koi doubts? Sambreen is asking, sir, MCQ session kab hoga? Beta, MCQ session will not be on Friday, Saturday, Sunday. It will be on weekdays. Monday to Thursday ke beech mein, jo 500 MCQ series that will be starting, will be doing it very soon. Moreover, other than this, we are also coming up with a number of other series. Jaise last 10 year economy questions. Kavale sir would be discussing last 10 year economy questions year wise, ek ek karke. So perhaps this week only we'll be starting it. In the same way, last 10 year geography questions, Bhushan sir would be discussing last 10 year geography questions. So those would be last year questions. Other than that, I will be coming up with a series. This week only I'll start with like at least 100 questions hum shuru kar denge, for environment, biodiversity and climate change. To revise through 500 questions. This series will be coming up with usme environment biodiversity bhi hoga. Uske baad we'll move to science and technology. We'll move to economy. And then if time permits, also ancient medieval culture. So we'll study ancient medieval culture. Uske baad questions bhi karne zaruri hai na. And these 500 questions would also be having past year questions. So around 100 past year questions would also be there. So for you doing these classes, going through those 500 questions should be enough for your preparation. Okay, so let's now go to electronic waste or e-waste. Koi doubt hai kya? Kisi ka koi doubt nahi hai. Chal. Electronic waste, e-waste. What is electronic waste? So e-waste is the disposed of electrical and electronic equipments. So in your home, a fan is there, which is there since the time of your dadaji. Or dadaji zyada ho jayega na? Since the time of your parents' marriage. Now ab kaam nahi kar raha hai. Kabadi, you'll give it to kabadi wala. Like you'll not be able to sell it second hand wale form mein. This waste is e-waste. इलेक्ट्रिकल इलेक्ट्रॉनिक कॉम्पोनेंट है. दिस वॉच आई डोंट नो ऑफ विच कंपनी इज इट, एक साल बाद खराब हो सकता है, इट विल बी थ्रोन अवे, बट इट हैज सर्टेन इलेक्ट्रॉनिक कॉम्पोनेंट्स इन इट. दिस वॉच, योर फोन, योर टीवी, योर रेफ्रिजरेटर, योर सीडी प्लेयर. When I was a kid, when I was a very small kid, there was a trend of Walkman. So I used to think that when I'll go to class 7, class 8, I'll buy a Walkman. But then there came the concept of CD player. By the time I was in class 6, 7, people were using those CD players. Now no one is using those, but eventually those went into the waste. That was electronic waste or e-waste. So think of any electrical electronic equipment around you. It would have some life. After that, it becomes waste. Electronic waste or e-waste. I hope समझ में आया e-waste overall क्या है. Now, in recent years, with advancement in science and technology, with penetration of internet, with more and more people using mobile phones and laptops, it is emerging as one of the most important component in the solid waste category. Because solid waste mein plastic waste would also come under solid waste. E-waste is also coming under solid waste. So it is one of the most fastly growing branches of the waste. Now we can divide e-waste into three categories. One, household appliances wala. So household appliances mein fan, refrigerators. These are mixer grinder. These are household appliances. They may not be having electronic component assets, but they have electrical components. These are white goods. Then there are brown goods. Brown goods mein we have TV, cameras. They have electronic components. You'll see, kabhi aapka, when your TV has been opened up in front of you, you'll see many integrated circuit boards there and all. Right. Then we have gray goods. Gray goods are computers, printers, fax machines, scanners, and so on. So white goods and brown goods are not that problematic. They are also e-waste. They also cause various pollution. But it is the gray goods which are the biggest problem, because they contain heavy metals like lead, cadmium, mercury, chromium, and so on, which are a big source of pollution. So white, brown, okay, gray, problematic. So white, brown are also not okay. They are also problematic, but gray is really, really dangerous. So why is e-waste harmful? E-waste is harmful because it contains all these things, lead, cadmium, and all those stuff. Now, how much of e-waste is produced in the world? So there's a report, Global E-Waste Monitor. First thing, who produces this report? UN University. UN University is producing this report. So it's because of 2020 report, which is talking about what is the situation in 2019, was published in somewhere in October, I guess. So this 2020 report, which is talking about the situation in 2019, says that globally 53.6 million tons of e-waste is produced every year. 50.36 million tons. Or tons, one ton is what? 1000 kg? So say 1000 kgs mein convert karoge, to 53 billion kgs. Every year of e-waste is being produced. Look at this image. 53.6 million tons or 53.6 billion kgs. What is the total population of Earth? 7 billion roughly. Yahan pe 53 billion tons. So almost 7.5 kg per head of e-waste is being produced every year. You getting this point? Every year, as per the 2020 report, in 2019 we produced 53.6 million tons or 53.6 billion kgs. World population is 7 billion, so roughly 7.5 or 7.3 kg per capita of e-waste was being produced. Where was, in terms of total volume, highest amount of e-waste was produced? In Asia. it will go as a continent wise, highest amount of e-waste of 24.9 million tons was produced in Asia. Almost 40% of the waste, more than 40% of the waste of the e-waste in the world was produced in Asia. Asia mein population bhi hai na, China hai, India hai, Japan is one of the very large producers of e-waste, advanced company. A number of Southeast Asian developing countries are hub of electronic production. So India, Asia is among the largest e-waste producer in the world, followed by Americas, Europe, Africa, and Oceania. So report me how much of e-waste is getting produced. Second thing you'll see, why e-waste is increasing so much. So these are the factors. One, higher levels of disposable income, more and more people buying fridge, washing machine, TV, radio, phones, computers. Urbanization, increased urbanization leads to more people using these equipments. Industrialization, higher consumption rates of electrical and electronics equipment, short life cycle. Like a fan, perhaps if you are living in the same home, you may have seen that you're using the same fan since last 15 years or so. They had long life, but mobile phones, perhaps you keep changing it every 2-3 years. Nahin? Like, kitne time mein apne phone change kiya aakhri? Batao mujhe chat mein. Like in general, what is the time period? Like, or since how long have you been, when was the last time you used a different phone? When compared to today's phone, koi nahi bata raha hai. 17. Okay. To 3-4 saal use kiya. 5 saal chala liya. Achha, unemployed log. Aap bhi 4 saal se same phone use kar rahe ho. Okay. Last year. Ye aaye na sachche log. Bhavani, same phone since last 4.5 years unemployed. Devesh Singh, last year. ये पापा के पैसे उड़ा रहा है. आयुषी लास्ट ईयर, ये भी घर वालों के पैसे उड़ा रही है. प्रवीण चौधरी, इट्स माय फर्स्ट वन. हाँ तो ठीक है, देखते हैं. उपमन्यु, फोर ईयर 4-4 साल से फोन यूज कर रहे हैं. ये तो थोड़ी मार्केटिंग में भी काम आई. कौन सा फोन है? चलिए एनीवेज, तो बिकॉज जनरली फोन्स हैव 4-5 ईयर साइकिल, लेट्स से 4-5 साल की साइकिल हो, यू विल बी टेकिंग केयर ऑफ, देन यू विल रिप्लेस इट. Laptops, again same thing, 5-6 years, you will be replacing them. Unlike televisions used to, like, we recently replaced the television in our home. The older television was there, we bought it in 2000. So 21 years ke baad, we replaced that TV. Wo itna mota TV tha. So it was a very important luxury then, a color TV and LG ka bada wala TV, and it was that. But now we realize ki, so 21 years extra. But recent, the new things, CD players or phones or iPods and all, you replace them quickly. Then short life cycle, few repair options. That's another major concern. I recently bought this Bluetooth earphone by OnePlus. I bought it in 2019 along with my phone. Now 2020 mein lag gaya lockdown and it stopped working. So I went to them when it had crossed 1 year wala period. So they say that now it's not in warranty. Maine kaha repair to kar do, warranty bhi nahi, paise de dunga. I said there is no repair option. That earphone which costed me 5,000 rupees had just become a waste. Ab 5,000 rupees lage to maine use abhi bhi table pe rakha hua hai, fekne ka man nahi kar raha. But they are not ready to repair. Repairing options are very less. This was an example which I got. I could see myself. Then there are some other facts, like India mein income badh raha hai. So India mein bhi ye sari cheeze badh rahi hai. These are some of the factors. But now come to other interesting part. Annually, it is growing by 2.5 million tons. Electronics and this the equipment. But when you will come to waste, waste has a growth of 9.2 million tons since 2014. So इलेक्ट्रॉनिक इक्विपमेंट चाहे लेस यूज हो रहे हैं, वेस्ट ज्यादा बढ़ रहा है. एनीवेज नॉट दैट इंपॉर्टेंट, बट दिस फिगर इज डायरेक्टली टेकन फ्रॉम, आई एम सॉरी, दिस फिगर इज डायरेक्टली टेकन फ्रॉम दिस रिपोर्ट विच इज टेलिंग यू वेर यू आर लोकेटेड इन टर्म्स ऑफ ओवरऑल प्रोडक्शन. एशिया हैज द लार्जेस्ट अमाउंट ऑफ वेस्ट, देन रिसाइक्लिंग ऑफ वेस्ट इज वेरी लेस. अगेन दिस फिगर इज टेकन फ्रॉम द रिपोर्ट ओनली. ऑफ द 53.6 मिलियन टन्स ऑफ वेस्ट दैट वॉज प्रोड्यूस्ड, ओनली 9.3 मिलियन टन ऑफ वेस्ट वॉज रिसाइकल्ड. अदर 44.3 मिलियन टन्स ऑफ वेस्ट, वेयर डिड दे गो? इन द ओपन डंप्स दैट वी वर टॉकिंग अबाउट, इन लैंडफिल्स, और आर नॉट डॉक्यूमेंटेड. इट मे बी लाइंग ऑन माई टेबल. One of the e-waste, it has become, my earphones have become e-waste for me. It's lying on the table there. Okay, now, the report is also saying that now number of countries which have their own national laws dealing with e-waste, their rules dealing with e-waste, they have increased to 78. In 2014, there were 61 countries which had this kind of thing. Now, more number of countries have national rules, regulations related to e-waste. Now, India is the fifth largest producer of e-waste in the world. Globally, 53.6 million tons e-waste produce hota hai. India mein 2.2 million tons e-waste produce hota hai, around 2 million tons, after China, USA, Japan and Germany. After these four countries, China obvious hai, USA, again, a powerful rich country with good population, Japan, a very small country with very small population, but still the third largest producer of e-waste. Because technologically advanced, so more electronic equipments etc. would be used by them. E-waste is an urban mine. Now, this e-waste which is we are releasing, we are throwing away, it consists of various precious metals, various other components which are expensive. It is said that the value of raw material in the global e-waste generated in 2019. So 2019 we have generated 53.6 million tons of e-waste. The value of material which is there is $57 billion. If you are properly able to recycle, extract all the useful things from that e-waste, itna worth hai unka. But still what we're doing, around more than 80% of that e-waste is getting wasted. It's not getting recycled. Okay, now, harmful effect of e-waste. What are the key harmful issues, key concerns associated with e-waste? First is, we already said that jo gray waste house mein we had cadmium, lead and all those things. So they consist of hazardous and toxic heavy metals. But other major concern related to e-waste is, see, e-waste mein we have also included household equipments, refrigerators and all. The older refrigerators, which were which your family may have bought 20 years back, they still contain, they contain, at that time we used chlorofluorocarbons and all those things, ozone depleting substances. So they may be containing ozone depleting substances or substances which may be causing climate change. The chlorofluorocarbons have been replaced by hydrofluorocarbons. Hydrofluorocarbons are not ozone depleting, but they have very high global warming potential. So we'll talk about, like, tomorrow or day after tomorrow, we'll start with climate change. There we'll talk about global warming potential and all. But wo gas, jiska warming ka capacity is much higher than the warming capacity of CO2, that has higher global warming potential. So these HFCs have higher global warming potential. So not only e-waste are toxic in nature, e-waste are hazardous in nature, they may cause ozone layer depletion, they may cause climate change. Then unscientific extraction, what people do to extract resources from this is, they burn it. Sometimes what antisocial elements do, they, in order to get metals from the, let's say, dumping site, they'll burn it. Now when they'll burn it, all the plastic and everything would be burned, what would be left was metal. But in the process, in this kind of thing, they end up sending a lot of air pollution, क्रिएटिंग अ लॉट ऑफ वाटर पोल्यूशन एंड सॉइल पोल्यूशन। तो ये हमने पढ़ा हुआ है कि कैसे हेल्थ इंपैक्ट कैडमियम का हो सकता है, लेड का हो सकता है, हैवी मेटल पोल्यूशन में हमने पढ़ा हुआ है। विल नॉट गो इनटू इट्स डिटेल अगेन, बट रिसेंटली अ स्टडी वॉज पब्लिश बाई WHO इन जून 2021। इट सेज दैट 18 मिलियन किड्स फ्रॉम लो एंड मिडिल इनकम कंट्रीज हु आर वर्किंग एट ई वेस्ट डंप साइट्स आर एट द रिस्क ऑफ हेल्थ हजार्ड्स। दिस रिपोर्ट वॉज चिल्ड्रन and digital dump sites. It was published abhi June 2021 mein. So children and digital dump sites, the report which is published by WHO, which is saying that 18 million people, 18 million children may face health hazards because of they working in this area. Harshita Lohia is typing, gift me one plus sir. और एवरीवन को भेजा है, वाह। भवानी ने बोला एलजी वाला, क्या सपने देख रहे हो क्या कि मैं वन प्लस गिफ्ट करूंगा, भवानी को एलजी वाला चाहिए। एनीवेज, इग्नोर ऑल दोस थिंग्स। तो इलेक्ट्रॉनिक वेस्ट क्या होता है, दैट इज अंडरस्टूड। हाउ मच ऑफ इलेक्ट्रॉनिक वेस्ट इज प्रोड्यूस्ड, दैट इज अंडरस्टूड। टू रिपोर्ट्स रिलेटेड टू ई वेस्ट दैट वी हैव डन, वन बाय यूनियन यूनिवर्सिटी एंड अदर, छोटा सा रिपोर्ट बाय WHO। नाउ e-waste management rules 2016, e-waste management ke liye bhi rules came in 2016. So what are the key changes that were brought? So first thing, was this the first management rule for e-waste? No. Please note, we already said in 2012 extended producer responsibility was introduced for e-waste. So e-waste ke liye rules pehle rahe honge, tab introduce hua hoga na. So these were not the first ones. What are the key changes which were done in this e-waste management rule? First thing that was done was the mercury containing products were included in the definition of e-waste. Mercury containing products like thermometers, not actually an electronic equipment or electrical equipment, but it is as harmful. Mercury is also heavy metal. So we said, let's also include it in the definition of e-waste so that it will also be managed properly. So मर्करी लाइट्स, थर्मोमीटर्स एंड ऑल दोस थिंग्स हैव बीन, CFLs हैव बीन इंक्लूडेड इन द डेफिनेशन ऑफ ई वेस्ट। देन EPR, एक्सटेंडेड प्रोड्यूसर रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी। द एक्सटेंडेड प्रोड्यूसर रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी वाज ऑलरेडी देयर फॉर ई वेस्ट, हेयर दे हैव स्ट्रीमलाइंड इट, दे हैव ब्रॉट इट अंडर द रूल बेस्ड सिस्टम वेयर दे हैव सेट टारगेट्स, टारगेट्स लाइक बाय 2017-18 producer should be able to recover 10% of waste generated by them. Then this should increase by 10% every year, and by 2023, 70% recovery should be there. Okay. Okay, मुझे अब चैट समझ में भी नहीं आ रहे लोग क्या बोल रहे हैं। एनीवेज, द एक्सटेंडेड प्रोड्यूसर, तो वी वर सेइंग द फर्स्ट थिंग दैट वाज डन वाज मर्करी प्रोडक्ट्स वर इंट्रोड्यूस्ड इन हियर। सेकंड, एक्सटेंडेड प्रोड्यूसर रिस्पांसिबिलिटी हैज बीन मॉडिफाइड अ बिट। नाउ टारगेट्स वर गिवन, तो अर्लियर 2016 में सम टारगेट्स वर गिवन, दोज वर नॉट गेटिंग फुलफिल्ड, दोज टारगेट्स वर मॉडिफाइड इन 2017-18। नाउ द टारगेट इज दैट बाय 2023 प्रोड्यूसर्स should be able to recover 70% of their waste. So basically, let's say Samsung, it is producing phones, it is selling phones, it is the responsibility of Samsung ki by 2023 the electronic equipment that they are producing, 70% of those electronic equipment, it should be able to recover. Extended producer responsibility has been brought in. Then there have been steps taken to reduce hazardous substances in the equipments. So certain hazardous substances have been banned, certain hazardous substances have to be regulated, restricted, and for testing whether your product has those hazardous substances or not, the testing is government's responsibility. But in case your product ends up having those hazardous, in that test it is found that it has hazardous substance, then cost of the test would also be given by you. Then state governments have the responsibility to ensure that people who are working in recycling of e-waste. They are working in a safe environment. They have been given proper skills so that in an unscientific manner, they are not extracting resources and getting exposed to those things. And finally, process of dismantling and recycling has been simplified. The process of basically, abhi tak kya hota tha ki to get registration permission for dismantling e-waste was a issue. It used to take a lot of time. Now it has been simplified. Now you have to get only one authorization, that from CPCB throughout the country, and you can initiate the system for dismantling and recycling of e-waste. Okay, so these are certain things in e-waste that we wanted to cover. E-waste kya hai, e-waste se problem kya hai, two reports that we have talked about, one by UN University, other by WHO, and then the e-waste management rules which are there in the country. Okay, now ek aur cheez kar lete hain, construction and demolition waste. It's a small thing. So see, construction and demolition waste, you understand kya hoga? When you are building a house or when you are constructing a house, a lot of waste remains, like broken bricks remain, some sand remains. Or when you are constructing a house over an older house, then you'll first break the older house. You'll first break the older building. You'll demolish the building. That is demolition waste. So construction and demolition waste is that. So here you may have glass while constructing a house. Windows may glass lag rahe honge. Kuch bach gaye, kuch break ho gaye. You may have wood. You may have plastic. You may have metal. You may have bricks. You may have stones. You may have cement. You may have a lot of other things. Those are construction and demolition waste. India did not take construction and demolition waste very seriously. And till 2016, it was covered under municipal waste management rules only. But in 2016, separate construction demolition waste management rules came up. Now we have separate construction and demolition waste management rule 2016, which calls for recycling, recovering, and reuse of the construction and demolition waste. What does it say? It says that it is mandatory to segregate construction and demolition waste into four types: concrete, soil, steel, and wood, plastic, bricks, and mortars. Okay, then they have to deposit this at the collection center or hand it over to the processing facility. It makes all stakeholders responsible for waste disposal. Chahe wo chota sa chota construction wala kaam ho, they're responsible for waste disposal. Then debris ka recycling is mandatory. Finally, illegal dumping has been banned. Uske liye punishment hoga. Waste processing authorities should have authorization from SPCB and should be located far away from habitation. So these are processing facilities. No, your construction waste has to go to processing facilities. These waste processing authorities, koi bhi nahi bana sakta ye. These waste processing authorities should have permission from SPCB and should be located far away from the habitation site. They should not be located within the city. Then for effective monitoring of the rules, specific roles have been allocated to CPCB, Bureau of Indian Standard, Indian Road Congress, Central Ministries, and so on. And Land Department is supposed to provide land for storage, processing, and recycling of construction and demolition waste. So you should slightly know that construction and demolition waste karke bhi rules hai, management rules hai. They were separated from municipal waste management rules in 2016. And you should know because they also cause pollution. So in pollution, I wanted to cover this as well. Okay, so let's stop today. Let's stop here today. Kal milte hain. Okay, class was from till 10, 8 to 10, 8 a.m. to 10 a.m. So ho gaya time. So kal milte hain. We'll continue with this and we'll also do the pending topic of the previous booklet and then we'll start with climate change. Okay, so this is the second last booklet. Next booklet on climate change will be the last booklet. Environment would be completed. Chaliye, I'll see you tomorrow.